So in the previous class, we have seen the definition of a machine learning and the what are the applications of the machine learning and the areas of the machine learning, and we winded up the class with looking into the type of machine learning, that is shallow learning and the deep learning. So now in today's class, now we'll go still ahead and we'll go for the classification of machine learning algorithms. Now how are we going to classify these algorithms? So generally you can see here, now we are going to classify the machine learning in algorithms into four different types of learning. The first one is called as supervised learning, right? Supervised learning, or it's also called as inductive learning. So then second category about unsupervised learning. The third one is semi-supervised learning, and the fourth one is reinforcement learning. So what are these four ways in which we are classifying our machine learning algorithm? Supervised, unsupervised, semi-supervised and reinforcement learning. So what do you mean by supervised learning? In a simple terms, if you want to say, supervised learning means the training data includes desired output. Now the training data, it has got what is the output is required. Right, if like say if x and y, so given an observation x, so x and y both are given for us. What is x? An observation x, which is the best labeled for y. So how the label is been given for x and the observation desired output is also known, so we call it as supervised learning. Some of the examples here is that machine learning, supervised learning is the classification and regression problem. Later we'll be looking into that. So it comes under supervised learning. Now when you go for unsupervised learning, training data does not include the desired output. So here in our training data, we don't have the output at all. So we call it as unsupervised. So only X is there. Given set of X or a summarization, now we want to predict something like say clustering. Some of the example, one of the example under unsupervised learning, we call it as clustering. The third type of learning is the semi-supervised learning. So here the training data includes a few desired outputs. Semi-supervised means it has both supervised learning and unsupervised learning. We can tag it as semi-supervised learning. And the fourth category we call it as reinforcement learning. Now here we are determining what to do based on rewards and punishments. So based on certain parameters, now what has to be done? Like say robot movement or some of the games in artificial intelligence, it comes under the reinforcement learning. So let us look more into what this type of learning say. The first is supervised learning. So the example, the very well known machine learning example which comes under supervised learning is classification problem. Now supervised learning, as the name indicates, that there is a supervisor. So supervisor learning is where you have some input variable X and an output variable Y. So you have got an input variable X and you have got an output variable Y, and you use an algorithm. Now you are going to use an algorithm to learn how you are going to map from this X to Y, to learn the mapping from the input to the output. So if X is an input and Y is an output, now you are going to write a function Y is equal to f of X. Now how it has been done. So the goal is to approximately this matching function. Now you have to come up with this matching function so well that when you have a new input X, right? So when a new input X is given, so your program has to match properly. It has to predict properly this new data input. It has to predict it belongs to which particular variable, output variable. So this is called as supervised learning. Now in another simple terms, you can say supervised learning, as the name says, supervisor, there is someone. So with the help of someone you are going to learn. Here the process of algorithm learning from the training data set, right? So there is a teacher, there is a supervisor who will train you. So will give who is going to give the input, and also he knows what is the output, right? So he is going to look at how you are going to learn based on the input and where how you are going to classify this input to the output. So he knows properly, the supervisor knows what is the correct answer, what is the correct answer and how you are going to map this input to the output. So we call this type of learning, which is called as a supervised learning. So one of the example is classification problem. Now the second, see, okay, we will take a simple example of how the supervised learning is going to work. Now you have got a supervised learning here, right? So now you have an input and you know the output. As we told, in supervised learning you have an input and you have got an output. Now here it is a classification problem. What it says is that you have to come up with a predictive model. Now what this model is going to work, or this machine learning is going to tell, what is this, is whenever you give an input image, it should classify, or it should tell that is it a duck or not, right? Already I think one video I have been shared in the classroom. Now similar to that, now how the program is able to identify a car and a dog, similar to this, now you can see here you want to design one predictive model. Now wherein which, so under supervised learning, because you know that what should be the output of this, the output is that if you give any image to this, it should identify whether that image is a duck or whether the image is not a duck. Now you start this. So to do this, to have this supervised learning, you have to take lot of inputs. You have got some duck images, different categories of images, and some are not duck. So whatever the image you give, so the program is going to predict that whether this image is a duck or whether it is not a duck. So this type of learning we call it as a supervised learning. So the second learning is called as the unsupervised learning. So example is clustering. So it's an unsupervised learning. Now what do you mean when unsupervised? Now you can just now think that supervised means there is some person, supervisor or a teacher, right? Unsupervised means nobody is there here. Nobody is there to teach you. So we can say unsupervised learning is where you only have the input data. You have the input data and no corresponding output variable is there, right? So the goal of unsupervised learning is to model the underlying structure or the distribution in the data, whatever the data, how it is distributed, in order to learn more about the data. Now you are going to learn more and more on the input, so unsupervised way. So there is no supervisor. So these are called unsupervised learning, because here, unlike supervised learning, now where a teacher was there or a supervisor was there who knows what was the correct answer, whereas here we don't know the answer, output is not there. Algorithms are left to their own device. So algorithm has to discover on its own, it has to predict on its own. So we call this as the unsupervised learning. Say for example, now in this diagram I think it will be very clear what you mean by unsupervised learning. Now you have seen the same diagram previously under supervised learning. Now you know what was the output. Now here there is no predictive model, nothing is there, right? We are just giving this input. If you give this image, so if you give this first image, this is a duck, this is a duck, and this is a duck. So we have got three duck images and there is two different images are there. So when these one by one images are given to your unsupervised learning, what it should do is it has to properly classify this. Now how it has been classified? Now there are three ducks images are there, one Mickey Mouse is there and one rabbit image is there, right? Now it has been doing, so we don't know, we were not knowing what was the output here, so nobody is telling. So just when these images are given, so normally, so what we try to do is, okay, this is something different image, this is something different category, or this all looks like a duck for us, so all ducks we make it in one group and we make this in different. This is what we call it as a unsupervised learning. The third type of learning is called as the semi-supervised machine learning. Now semi-supervised means both, you can say, problem where you have large amount of input data X and only few amount of data which is labeled as Y. Amount of data which is labeled as Y. So we call semi-supervised learning problem. Now this problem, it is between supervised and semi-supervised. So if you take an example is that the photo archive. So we have got photo archive where only some of the images are labeled. When you look into the photo archive, some images will be labeled, a majority of your images are unlabeled. So we can call that as a semi-supervised learning. Now this diagram, in a very broad way, it gives all the different types of machine learning algorithm, maximum, or we can say very famous well-known algorithm. So when you are going to divide this machine learning, supervised learning and unsupervised learning. So we said another one also is there, right? Semi-supervised, which comes in between only, and we told reinforcement learning. So reinforcement learning generally it comes in artificial intelligence and games, right? Now when you look here, the supervised and unsupervised learning. So the supervised learning is further two categories of algorithms we are having. One type is called as classification, the other one is called as regression. So we have classification and regression, both comes under the supervised learning. Now when you look into this classification, we have many algorithms are there, like say support vector machine, discriminant analysis, Navy Bayes and nearest neighborhood algorithm. These are all the examples algorithms which is based on classification problems. Like say when you have got a problem which you are going to categorize that particular problem under classification, which comes under supervised learning, you can select any one of these algorithm. Now how to write this algorithm, sir? You need not worry about all this. So as we said that in Python or any other programming languages, if you go for machine learning, all this algorithm right now it is built in. You need not worry about how to write that algorithm or how it is going to work. All these algorithms are built in, available. Only thing is you should know which algorithm should be used for which type of problems. So and how you are going to import that functions or these algorithms in your programming language. Similarly, under supervised learning, we have the second classification categories of algorithm called as regression, and we have some examples like linear regression or neural networks or SVR, GPR. There are different types of algorithms are there. And unsupervised, we have clustering. Now under clustering also, we have different types of categories of algorithms have been available for us. Is clear? These are the different two different classifications what you can do. Now this is another diagram. Now when in which we are trying to look into some of the applications of when we are considering the machine learning, when we go for supervised learning. As we said, under supervised learning we have classification and regression. So when you are talking about classification, like say identity fraud detection, so credit card fraud detection, right? So there are so many applications which comes under that. So it comes which we can call it as classification problem or image classification. You give one image and it has to classify it based on which customers related to diagnostics. All these are the examples of classification. When you go into regression, weather forecasting an example which comes under the regression, or the market forecasting, estimating the life expectancy of a particular person or human being. Similar, the population growth prediction, all this comes under the regression classification. When you go for unsupervised, one is clustering and then other one is dimensionally reduction. So when you are talking about clustering, some of the applications like say customer segmentation or targeting the marketing are there, right? So these are the some of the applications related to our supervised learning and unsupervised learning, and we have got reinforcement learning as we were discussing. So generally reinforcement learning related to robot navigations, how the robot has to navigate, and similarly some of the games. Now we try to use usually reinforcement learning. So this diagram in a broad sense, it tells us that what all the areas of applications are available for us. Okay, so let us try to look why machine learning is very important for us, because some task cannot be well defined, right? There are so many applications or so many tasks which is not defined properly, like say for example recognizing the people, right? So we try to recognize each other. Now all of you can recognize me, right? But you people cannot recognize your teacher who taught you in LKG. Why it happens so? Or your teacher who has taught you in first standard. Some people can recognize, but majority, can you recognize all the teachers who taught you in LKG? Or we can say that Can you recognize all the teachers who taught you from LKG till you were postgraduate? It's very difficult. So there are certain tasks which is very, very difficult for us to define. One like recognizing people, right? Relationship and correlations can be hidden within the large amount of data. Now at that time our data mining or machine learning, you know, it helps us a lot, especially because many of the times we human beings, many of the applications, it becomes very difficult for us to recognize, even like say in predicting the future or the about the sales or the fraud detection or the medical diagnostic. Because like say medical diagnostic, if you take the amount of huge amount of knowledge required, it's very, very huge. And also to understand how the human brain is working and how he is responding to a particular drug, it's very, very complicated for human beings to analyze the particular data. Now in that particular places, the machine learning is going to help a lot. That is why today machine learning is becoming very important. Right, and also the environment is changing over time. As we know that knowledge keeps on changing, so new knowledge is so much changing that you as a human being, it is very difficult to handle all these things. So we need a machine which can handle the changes what is happening in the day-to-day activity. Okay, that's why the machine learning is so important. Now let us understand what is the skill set. So that today I want to become a machine learning engineer, data, even want to take up your career in this. Now what are the skill set is required? Even though obviously that in our course we are learning the machine learning to some extent, right? But to become completely, if you want to get a sufficient amount of knowledge, now you need some of the mathematical skills like say probability, statistics, linear algebra. Of course calculus is not much required, but probability and statistics are basic amount of things is compulsory required. That is a mathematical skill. Programming skills, obviously you know a lot of programming language. Additionally you have to learn like say Python or R is required. Data engineering skill is also required to become a machine learning engineer. Data analysis, visualization, and similarly of course this thing, the knowledge in our machine learning, you should know what all the machine learning algorithms, supervised, semi-supervised, unsupervised, what algorithms are there. So these are all the some of the skill set which is required for anyone to completely become a complete machine learning engineer. So now this is what we come to the in summary. Now if you want to look why machine learning is great for us, because the problems for which the existing solution, so whatever the problem we are having from existing solution, so where lot of hand tuning or you can say rules are there, humans has to do lot of things, but the machine learning algorithms can make this simple, this code very simple, and it can perform better, performance also is better. And complex problem for which there is no good solutions at all, so those type of complex problem, so by traditional approach where we were not having the solutions, so the machine learning techniques can be used in order to get the solution. Similarly, faulting environment, so it can detect the new data. If any new data are coming, detection and identifying the fraud detection, all these things can be easily done where the machine learning is very great for us. Similarly, even though when we are telling lot of things, there are certain issues also asked there in order to when we are trying to use the machine learning, like say which algorithm can approximate function well and when, which algorithms has to be used. We have so many algorithms are available, which algorithm should be used for us, how well it is going to improve our performance measure, right? So these are some of the key issues which we are supposed to discuss way before you try to implement. Now how does the number of training example influence accuracy? Now if you want to accurately tell your model, you have implemented a ML program, so how much accuracy, for having more and more accuracy, how much training is required for us, how much number of data is required for us, right? How does the complexity of hypothesis representation impacts the hypothesis what you are doing, There are certain assumptions what you are making when you are going to do the training. Now, how complexity it is. Now, what about the noisy data? So when you are collecting the data, so that's what we say, when you collect the data, data cleaning is very, very important. So how well you are going to clean the data, right? So similarly, is there a theoretical limit for learning? So when you are trying to build a machine learning, is there a limit, a cap you are going to put, the upper end cap you are going to put theoretically for learning? Now that particular thing, now, how can the system alter its own representation, right? So how it is going to change, how it is going to learn? So these are all the various issues, some of the issues which has to be addressed when you are going to look. Now, this is the trend or the how the machine learning came to the picture. So right from 1950s, so initially we were having artificial intelligence. So artificial intelligence is once again not a new subject. In 1950s only AI was there, but unfortunately it came into picture once our hardware and the technology started improve, right? So initially we had artificial intelligence, then we are having machine learning, right? So now we are in the age of deep learning. But unfortunately, even though we are in the age of deep learning, but at least now you are studying machine learning in your subject, right? So you learn the machine learning, but in reality already we are in the deep learning. And these are all the textbooks, I think, the prescribed books which are available. This is the last thing. We are going to wind up this particular session. Even though whenever we are having a lot and lot of machine learning program, unfortunately we human beings are losing our own intelligence, right? So we don't remember anything because we are making the system to learn. So these are the introduction lecture about our machine learning. So from the next series onwards, now we will go into the machine learning. As been told in the previous class also, we'll start with one particular example called as the checker game. And for that particular game, now how you are going to model, how you are going to build the machine learning, try to analyze that particular game and how you are going to build and what are the important stages are there. Now all those things we will be discussing in our next class. So if you have got any doubts in this introduction part, feel free to put a queries in the, either the classroom or in the WhatsApp group. Thank you. Have a nice day. Bye bye.